Spoilers ahead.
For the Rob Zombie filmography.
This is really good. Here, have some.
Rob Zombie is an accomplished musician and filmmaker.
Besides the music videos he's directed and the horror films he's known for, he directed an animated feature called The Haunted World of El Super Bisto and the recent Netflix revival of Monsters.
I vaguely recall watching House of a Thousand Corpses about 20 years ago. I just rewatched it during this Halloween season.
I did not like this movie when I first saw it. It has grown on me over 20 years, and I want to talk about some of the strengths and weaknesses. First, I want to point out in that every interview I have read, Rob Zombie kind of dismisses this movie. I wouldn't say he disavows it, but he admits that it was his first go. He was getting a lot of ideas out of his system, and he really used the experience to learn better on the job how to make films. Even though the movie was filmed and released in the early aughts, it feels very 90s. The beginning of the movie is more of a gritty crime sequence, and while I enjoyed it, felt like watching Love in a 45 or something like that. And there's a lot of music video style cuts to shot on video footage, the bulk of which I understand was shot after principal filming was done. The style does feel dated, and there's so many cuts that it's distracting. That's what I didn't like about it the first time around, and it still wasn't the best this time around.
What I do appreciate in hindsight is that they get period details right. This takes place on Halloween 77, which is a year before Michael Myers comes home, by the way, and a few years after the Texas Chainsaw Massacre timeline. But there was one part in particular in Don Willis's house when he's on the phone. The house just looks 70s. It's perfect. One great thing about Rob Zombie is the detail he puts into the sets. Also noticed that that's Otis Driftwood himself, Bill Moseley, as the newscaster. So I read an interview where Rob Zombie says, as far as it pertains to House of a Thousand Corpses, at least, he didn't mean for the audience to root for the Firefly family. He was trying to make these four young people like I will say that I like Aaron Daniels from L Word. Jennifer Jostyn seems cool, says nice things about the movie, and has participated in anniversary reunions for the film, as has Daniels. Rainn Wilson is always hit or miss with me. I loved him in Cooties, didn't like him in this, but he's at least more likable than the other guy, who's not even likable in real life, and that's all we're going to talk about him.
There were too many characters in this movie, and I get that it was an homage to Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
As far as the big family around the dinner table, but Rob Zombie definitely did the right thing by having a stripped down cast for The Devil's Rejects.
It is saddening to think of all the folks who were in this movie that have passed away, including Matthew McGorry, and of course, our beloved Sid Haig, who I personally met at Mad Monster Party some years ago. I will always love Sid Haig. It's not even like him and I in particular bonded. He was just so sweet to my son, and that's always going to go a long way with me. I've always been a big Bill Moseley fan, and he's kind of doing a scaled down Chop Top here. It's not the same Otis that you see in Devil's Rejects or Three from Hell. You get a little taste of that with the Boogeyman speech.
It's all true. The Boogeyman is real, and you found him.
But other than that, it's just interesting, a different interpretation of the character. And finally, as we see Baby here, who's not that much different than the rest of the trilogy, I think about how people treat Sherry Moon Zombie. If it were a man in this role, if it were a man who had created such a memorable, demented character, people would be treating them with a whole lot more respect than I see Sherry Moon Zombie get.
While two studios ended up backing out of putting out House of a Thousand Corpses, Lionsgate finally took the plunge, which paid off with a $17 million box office, and so a sequel was greenlit. And while given half the budget of House of a Thousand Corpses, he was given so much pre-production time and able to spend efficiently instead of the big studio way of financing and accounting that he still designates this as his favorite filming experience.
Yeah, the budget on this is maybe half of the first one, but I think it'll look twice as big as the first one, just because I just know the money on the first one was just wasted. I thought it was getting on screen, but I don't think it really was.
Actually, instead of us going more over budget, I think we're going more under budget every day that Rob keeps thinking about how to do things a little more cheaply and succinctly.
The Devil's Rejects takes place 6 months after the events of House of a Thousand Corpses. One of the lawmen killed in the first film has a brother coming back to avenge him, played here by William Forsythe, whose most notable films besides the comedy Raising Arizona have been action films and crime thrillers, which Devil's Rejects kind of fits. It is more of a 70s road picture, more inspired by Bonnie and Clyde, Badlands, The Wild Bunch. Most of the Firefly family is wiped out. Tiny is missing in action. Mama is apprehended. She is played by Leslie Easterbrook of Police Academy. It's too bad scheduling with Karen Black didn't work, but Easterbrook is great. Baby and Otis sneak out of the compound, steal a car from Mary Warrenoff, you know, from so many great films, Night of the Comet, a cameo in Chopping Mall, and unfortunately, she's not the only Rock and Roll High School cast member whose car gets jacked. And Baby and Otis make their run. They give a warning to Captain Spaulding, who is implicated in the murders. They plan to meet at a motel, get a new car, and head out to a brothel run by their associate, Charlie, played by Ken Foray. You know him from Dawn of the Dead, From Beyond, a whole bunch of stuff. Michael Berryman from The Hills Have Eyes and Weird Science is one of the associates. One of the sex workers is E.G. Daly. We'll talk about her again in a little bit. The poor souls that end up encountering the Firefly family is a family country band called Banjo and Sullivan. So look, there is a lot that has been talked about. These scenes, what happens to them. There is an assault that could be very triggering. I mean, this movie is a lot more explicit about Otis being a predator and abuser. It's not an aspect of the character to be celebrated. It's not an act that is to be glorified. And it's something that a lot of people don't even want in their horror movies. Rob Zombie had said that the whole point was to make Otis and Baby and Spaulding as vile as possible and then see if the audience would still root for them when the tables get turned on them. Meanwhile, Spaulding has a darkly comic encounter with PJ Souls of Carrie, Rock and Roll High School, lots of good movies, as he commandeers her vehicle for official clown business. As mentioned before, Otis is a lot more brutal in this film and even channels some Manson family vibes.
I am the devil, and I am here to do the devil's work.
I would say this movie is more darkly comic as opposed to campy like the first film. The ice cream scene is really the turning point, and we're now in the POV of the Firefly family as our protagonists. So there's a similarity here to 1972's Last House on the Left, written by Nightmare on Elm Street creator Wes Craven and produced by Friday the 13th creator Sean Cunningham, where we see the murderers become the hunted. But in Last House on the Left, the killers were still the antagonists. The lawman is the antagonist here now, and a vigilante. Here he's hiring thugs, played by former WCW world champion Diamond Dallas Page and the legendary Danny Trejo. In case you haven't seen this movie and now you want to, I won't reveal what happens to Mama or at the brothel, but we'll say some people make it there, some people don't make it out. But our sheriff here and the Firefly family end up back at the house. So critics found a lot of parallels between the way William Forsythe's corrupted lawman here is interrogating and torturing the Firefly family and what was going on with the war on terrorism, Guantanamo Bay. Rob Zombie says he had none of that in mind. It was simply about garnering sympathy for these killers whose acts you despised in the beginning of the movie, but now you're seeing them try to save each other, cover for each other. You even see Baby run from the lawman like her victims in House of a Thousand Corpses ran from her. Again, I'm not filling in all the details in case you want to go enjoy the movie for the first time, but Tiny, who is missing in action, and the lawman, well, their fates end up coinciding. At the end here, we're really left with just Otis, Baby, and Spaulding. Very injured, very compromised from their run-in with the law. They're going to get away and move on to their adventures in the sequel, right? Right? This sequence is why I still call The Devil's Rejects one of my favorite horror movies of all time. Because it's not just a horror movie, it's a road movie. It's an outlaw movie. It's a movie about family, a twisted family. And in this sequence, we see what I interpret as their views of themselves. I don't think they're remembering happier times. I think these are delusions of how they see themselves as one big happy family. But the use of Lynyrd Skynyrd's Freebird, which at this point, if you were in music at all, you know it was a song that was just kind of called out as a joke. Hey man, play Freebird. But it's somehow given its seriousness back. It becomes this solemn ballad about these outlaws who will never change. You think of the beginning of the movie when they were ready to lose it all in a gunfight with the law. I mean, Otis and Baby did run away, but this time with Captain Spaulding, who they call Dad, Daddy, when justice finally catches up with them, they are ready to go out in a blaze of glory. But it's ugly. I can't even show it. And so that's the end for Otis, Spaulding, and Baby, right? No sequel, right? Just like E.G. Daily, we'll talk about it later. Devil's Rejects made 3 times its budget back at the box office. And so Rob Zombie was handed the keys to one of horror's quintessential franchises. There's already been a lot of commentary videos on Halloween and Halloween 2. There's even a 4-hour behind-the-scenes documentary you can watch. So I'm going to take a slightly different route here and talk about Quentin Tarantino. So Tarantino and Robert Rodriguez, who had teamed up before on From Dusk Till Dawn, set out to make this very ambitious double feature called Grindhouse. It comes out to over 3 hours. It's 2 features, one helmed by each writer-director, and then a bunch of trailers, fake trailers, by other writers and directors. Rob Zombie did one called Werewolf Women of the SS. This association with Tarantino, not surprising at all. They both are children of 70s grindhouse films. That's their influence. I believe you can also see Quentin Tarantino's influence on Rob Zombie. I've talked with a few folks on TikTok this week about what we jokingly call the Tarantino to Zombie pipeline. As far as if you are a fan of House of a Thousand Corpses, you're probably a fan of Pulp Fiction, for instance. But you can hear Tarantino-ish dialogue on a lot of Rob Zombie films, some of which we'll talk about in a little bit. But it occurred to me that both Tarantino and Zombie made their first 2 films within their own universes. Tarantino has the Vega Brothers universe with Reservoir Dogs and Pulp Fiction, and Rob Zombie, of course, has the Firefly family universe. And then their third act was an adaptation for Tarantino, Elmer Leonard's Rum Punch, and making that into Jackie Brown, which is arguably his greatest film. I know, the argument online is Inglourious Basterds versus Pulp Fiction, but I'm telling you, Jackie Brown, number one. And then, of course, Rob Zombie had the opportunity to make his own Halloween, and he was asked back for Halloween 2. By the way, another Tarantino and Zombie shared trait is they like to cast veteran actors who you may not have seen on the screen in a while. John Travolta, of course, famously making a comeback in Pulp Fiction. But an actor who Tarantino and Zombie both had in common was Sid Haig. Seen here as a judge in Jackie Brown. And again, here behind the bar that Bill's brother Bud works at in Kill Bill Volume 2. Halloween and Halloween 2 had its share of interesting casting as well. Malcolm McDowell's Loomis buys a gun from gun shop owner Mickey Dolenz from the Monkees. And don't forget, he was also TV's Circus Boy. And Halloween 2 had Margot Kidder as Laurie Strode's therapist. Come on, Kidder, Black Christmas, Sisters, The Amityville Horror, of course, Lois Lane in the Superman movies. Tons of shows and movies in the 90s and aughts. We lost her a couple years ago. Definitely very missed. So after a long audition process, Scout Taylor Compton got the role of Laurie Strode. She had been in a respectable amount of TV roles, couple movies, but this was her first real big starring vehicle. And I would hope that even those who don't like Zombie's version of Halloween necessarily still give Scout Taylor Compton her due. Dee Wallace, by the way, has worked plenty every decade, but I think this was her first real high-profile film since 1996, The Frighteners, and she's been part of what I call the zombie troop ever since. My son and I got a little time with her at Mad Monster Party. She's the coolest. But of course, the most awesome casting in this, Danielle Harris. He was Jamie Lloyd in the original Halloween franchise's sequels, and Zombie brings her into his Halloween universe as Annie Brackett. And though she had been working sporadically after her career as a child and young adult actor, this really propelled her back into working regularly. She's part of lots of great movies, including the Hatchet series, and Tarantino cast her in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. I previously discussed Brea Grant in a review of a movie she directed, Torn Heart. She had done some significant TV roles and some smaller movies, including one we were both in called Weathered Underground. Halloween 2 was her first major feature role, and she remains a force in film and the horror genre. I could go on about all the great horror casting. I mean, we didn't even get to Brad Dourif, the voice of Chucky in Child's Play. But let's talk about the divisiveness of these movies.
I don't think that the stories are that fundamentally different from the original John Carpenter Halloween 1 and Halloween 2. I think what's different, of course, is Rob Zombie's approach, both in using the first half of the first Halloween of his to dive more into the backstory of Michael Myers. And I think that's a valid choice, a valid thing to explore for his version, even if people didn't like it, even if people thought that The Shape should just be completely baseless, no history that we really know of. Although even the original Michael Myers had a history, it's just expanded upon in this Rob Zombie version. He also, frankly, takes a more artistic approach to these movies.
Now, there's still some Firefly-style sleazy things. For instance, in the director's cut of Halloween 1, Michael's escape from Smith's Grove, two orderlies assault and violate a female patient in Michael's cell. Michael takes advantage of that situation to escape. The theatrical version is Michael bashing some guards during a transfer.
But, especially in Halloween 2, is very experimental, and you can see shades of stuff that's going to happen on Lords of Salem. I think Rob Zombie's versions of Halloween 1 and Halloween 2 are valid and artistic. I think a lot worse has been done with a lot of other franchises that have been rebooted. Think about all the lousy Texas Chainsaw Massacre movies. Think about how disappointed people were in the reboot of A Nightmare on Elm Street. We can differ on whether any of those movies are good.
That's right. Do your thing, cuz.
Texas Chainsaw 3D rocks. But anyway, you can't argue with the fact that Rob Zombie tried to see his vision through. Unfortunately, there was a lot of studio meddling. You can hear the interviews Rob Zombie's given since.
He was dealing with the Weinsteins, which, ick. He characterizes the Halloween 1 and 2 experiences as his least favorite in filmmaking.
Previously, he would vacillate between film and music, and this was no different. He took another break, concentrated on his music career, but he would come back with something very intriguing. Besides all the great performances I previously mentioned, there's Dayton Kelly of Sons of Anarchy and Deadwood fame, and a Welsh actor recommended by Sid Haig to Rob Zombie named Richard Brake. Talk a lot about him later. Another actor popping up here on the Rob Zombie radar for the first time is Jeff Daniel Phillips. He had written, produced, and directed his own short film Hyde, and had roles in Sneakers and Zodiac. Of course, the most important figures left at the end of the movie are Malcolm McDowell's Loomis, Scout Taylor Compton's Laurie, and Michael Myers, played by Tyler Mayne. Now, Maine had started out as a professional wrestler,
but then transitioned into acting roles like Sabretooth from X-Men and Rufus in The Devil's Rejects.
Really brought the imposing physicality to the role in a great way, which I think should be credited more. Not done talking about characters in the scene, though. We have young Michael, and we have Sherry Moon Zombie's Mama Myers as well. This movie, whether in the director's cut or the theatrical cut, used a lot of kind of dream logic and imagery, and that is something we would see more of in the next live action feature. But there are two projects I just want to take a few minutes to talk about. The first being The Haunted World of El Superbisto. This is an animated feature that Rob Zombie made with comedian Tom Papa. Zombie worked on and off of this for a few years, and it came out after Halloween 2. It has a bunch of Rob Zombie regulars. It has this kind of Family Guy-like habit of referencing things, and it's referencing B-movies, horror, set up like an adventure story, but with sci-fi creatures and even more supernatural monster zombies, like in the fake trailer in Grindhouse. You have Bill Moseley in there as Otis Driftwood and Sid Haig as Captain Spaulding. There's even some Banjo and Sullivan, and the antagonist is named Dr. Satan. Seems like a completely different character, though, than the House of a Thousand Corpses Dr. Satan. But track it down anyway if you are a Rob Zombie Firefly family universe completist, or if you're a fan of the works of Tom Papa, who voices the titular character, El Superbisto, or if you are just a fan of adult animation. Now, it's not my area of expertise, but I am tempted to say that this is a mix of the absurdity of Ren and Stimpy with the political incorrectness of South Park and perhaps a Ralph Bakshi influence. But it's been years since I attended Bike and Mike Festival, so take that with a grain of salt. It wasn't my sense of humor.
Hi there, Bisto. Good to see you back.
Well, it's good to see you're back, too. Or should I say, crack?
Oh,
But it is a very interesting and colorful universe that Rob Zombie has created here. I'd be curious to see the comic books that he wrote that this movie was based on. And it did help inform me on his comic sensibility a bit as it pertains to the monsters,
which we'll take a look at in a bit.
Rob Zombie also snuck in a television directorial gig, what he jokingly calls the worst 3 weeks of his life, or maybe not jokingly, CSI Miami, their Los Angeles episode. Apparently he was a fan of the show, and they reached out to him just like they had Quentin Tarantino previously, but notorious misbehaved series star David Caruso made it a little bit difficult for Rob Zombie. Not a surprise, he was making things difficult for everybody then. Still, Zombie got to get William Forsythe on the show, and Malcolm McDowell, who took the job just to terrorize Caruso.
He came on set and f***ing tortured. Malcolm was determined to always have the last line in a scene, even if it wasn't scripted, to always get in the way. There's one scene where Malcolm's supposed to be just on the phone for a second, and David's supposed to walk in and say, like, you know, whatever. And Malcolm wouldn't hang up the phone. He kept ad-libbing this phone call like he was on the phone with his girlfriend. And I could see David's face turning red. And he finally said, hang up the phone. And Malcolm's like, hold on, love. And he keeps talking and turns his back just to aggravate him. It was hilarious.
Besides playing music and doing things like announcing pay-per-view participants on WWE Monday Night Raw, Rob Zombie was looking at two film properties to possibly develop. Another remake of The Blob, and a story about the notorious Philadelphia Flyers, National Hockey League team of 1974. But Blumhouse Productions had started to make a big splash in horror with the Paranormal Activity movies and Sinister. They offered Rob Zombie full control over creative, casting, and final cut if he could deliver a supernatural movie with a limited time frame and budget.
Welcome.
What if some of the women executed in the witch trials were actually guilty? Lords of Salem imagines them re-emerging to seek revenge on the descendants of those who executed them. This is a story Rob Zombie had been working on for several years, and then he pulled out of the drawer to finish for this Blumhouse project. There were differences between his original concept and what he figured he could get away with filming, and some of what lied in between ended up in a novelization that came out later. The story, as in the film release, is about these witches taking advantage of a trio of radio DJs. Jeff Daniel Phillips makes his second appearance in the Rob Zombie film as sensitive and thoughtful Herman Salvador, aka Whitey. Look, it's our old friend Ken Foray here as Herman Jackson. Yes, there's two Hermans in this film, so that's why they call the other guy Whitey. And Sherry Boone Zombie is Heidi LaRocque, a recovering addict who's also dealing with strange hallucinations around the time the station receives a mysterious record from a band only known as the Lords. There are other women in Salem also having reactions to the record when it's played, including Barbara Crampton, here in her first role after her comeback in You're Next.
May I ask you, where did you get that music from?
Bruce Davison from rat horror movie Willard, X-Men, and the 1996 film version of The Crucible, is a local author and witch trial expert who becomes interested in the mysterious record.
Heidi also starts spending more time with her nosy but protective landlord and the landlord's sisters, played by Dee Wallace, in her second of many Rob Zombie film appearances to come, and Belfast, Ireland's own Patricia Quinn,
who has had many movie and television roles, but is best known as Magenta from the Rocky Horror Picture Show.
And the landlord, head sister in charge, and den mother of this whole gang is played by British actress and powerhouse Judy Geeson. We'd be here all day if I tried to name all her credits, but most notably to Sir With Love, Hammer Films' Fear in the Night, and American sitcom Mad About You. And present in flashbacks and hallucinations as the head of the Salem Coven is Meg Foster. She was in Peckinpah's Osterman Weekend, the TV miniseries version of The Scarlet Letter, John Carpenter's They Live, and many have praised her portrayal of a feral satanic witch in this film.
So veteran character actor Richard Lynch had already appeared in the first Rob Zombie Halloween movie as Michael Myers' principal, and he was brought on to Lords of Salem for the flashback scene in the Salem witch trial times. Unfortunately, this was in the later era of his life. His vision was much more impaired than when he had worked on Halloween. Having problems even just kind of getting through the dialogue, they decided to wrap, and because of the tight timeline of the production, they just didn't return to
getting any more coverage on his scenes, and Lynch's part was drastically reduced. So unfortunately were the scenes that were to include Sid Haig and Michael Berryman. All that material was supposed to connect with scenes for later in the movie, and because the prologue wasn't there, those modern day scenes didn't make sense, and so Rob Zombie had to yank those out of the film as well. And just a lot more material he had hoped to be in the final cut was trimmed out. So between the motifs of religion and the sacrilegious, logic and imagery from dreams or perhaps nightmares, and even Rob Zombie foregoing his usual handheld camera shots and breakneck pacing, and instead going for more of a slow burn, more intricate camera setups than he was used to, heard him tell Mick Garris in an interview on Postmortem that he decided to do the opposite of what his instincts usually would tell him while shooting this movie. With all that, you see the equal influences of Roman Polanski, Andrei Zulofsky, Stanley Kubrick, William Friedkin, Ken Russell. And with a cocktail that volatile, he had a lot of issues securing locations within Salem and definitely especially churches. And by the way, we get another assault scene, another violation involving a priest, but it is a hallucination. It's symbolic, so I don't know if that makes it better than what happened in A House of a Thousand Corpses and Devil's Rejects, but be warned. Nevertheless, despite all the challenges, Rob Zombie tackles his most ambitious project yet, and I think he succeeds. It's visually stunning. It's more emotional than any Rob Zombie project yet. Sherry Moon Zombie isn't crazy baby here, and she isn't a symbol or a reflection of Michael Myers' psyche. She's playing a really three-dimensional, complicated protagonist in this. Probably her best acting yet. I've only given you the broad strokes of the plot. Go unveil the mystery for yourself and enjoy what is technically probably Rob Zombie's best motion picture. Unfortunately, Lords of Salem was Rob Zombie's first movie that didn't recoup at the box office. Kind of broke even once you figured in international, and it certainly turned a profit on home market, but if you compare it to the return that House of Thousand Corpses made, or the millions of dollars at the box office that Halloween and Halloween 2 brought in, unfortunately it didn't move the needle in that way. So what would Rob Zombie make next? He's been attached to all sorts of projects in development over years, the aforementioned Blob remake and hockey movie. He'd been in talks to do a Crow remake, a Manson family TV series, different wrestling and boxing stories, film adaptations of his own comic books, even a Groucho Marx biopic. Rob Zombie had released new films every 2 to 3 years since A House of Thousand Corpses. If we don't count his concert film, The Zombie Horror Picture Show, then the time between Lords of Salem and his next feature
is the longest break so far,
from 2012 to 2016. Having done 2 studio films of a property he didn't create, a tightly scheduled, tightly budgeted film that was out of his usual style, and needing a new financing strategy having not recouped his last movie, he decided to shoot primarily in one location, utilize crowdfunding in part of the budget, and get back to the kind of story he was telling with A House of a Thousand Corpses or A Devil's Rejects. After a mixed experience with the fundraising, which did end up paying for some pre-production and post-production, he ended up showing the film through a Fathom theatrical event and then going to streaming as a Shudder exclusive. He had an idea based on an article he had read about more people going missing on October 31st than any other day of the year. He wrote 2 of his protagonist roles for Sherry Moon Zombie and Jeff Daniel Phillips. He wrote a part for Judy Geeson to return, an overseer of the violence that would happen. He also ended up bringing back Malcolm McDowell as one of the other overseers. And wrote 1 part specifically, the main antagonist, for an actor who had been on Game of Thrones, Batman Begins, Hannibal Rising, Doom, Steven Spielberg's Munich, Brian De Palma's The Black Dahlia, Marvel's Thor, The Dark World, and most recently with Zombie, a role Sid Haig had recommended him for in Halloween 2. Welsh actor Richard Brake, who would become an integral part of Rob Zombie's troupe in future movies. '31 is another Rob Zombie movie taking place in the 70s. And channels another auteur inspired by that decade, Quentin Tarantino. Richard Brake's Doomhead
begins the film with a very Tarantino-esque monologue. We'd heard bits and pieces of this kind of thing in previous Rob Zombie movies, but this was the first where I think it was really clear. And feelings may be mixed on that kind of style, but Richard Brake rises to the challenge and cements himself as a key Rob Zombie player for years to come.
Hello. They call me Doomhead. Now, I don't call myself Doomhead, mind you, but they do. Who's they? Well, some mysterious folks that pay me a whole lot of scratch to do what I do. And what I do, unfortunately for you, I do real well.
Daniel Roebuck, who got his start in punk rock cult films River's Edge and Dudes, and later found more fame on programs like Lost and Matlock and movies like The Fugitive, U.S. Marshals, and The Late Shift, has been in every Rob Zombie vehicle, including El Super Bisto, since The Devil's Rejects and up until the recent The Munsters, where he played Grandpa. Here, he is a captive priest listening to Doomhead explain that he's going to kill him. You may remember that Rob Zombie's first film, House of 1000 Corpses, takes place on Halloween 1977 and involves four young people being lured into a house where monstrous killers reveal themselves, with the film having allusions to Texas Chainsaw Massacre. 31 takes place on Halloween 1976 and involves a group of five carnival workers being grabbed and taken to a place where murderous killers reveal themselves. And the movie has allusions to 1932's The Most Dangerous Game, or Arnold Schwarzenegger's The Running Man, if you prefer. There's also a scene that's apparently an homage to Rocky Horror Picture Show, but explaining that to you would be a spoiler. And I haven't seen that film since the one time I saw it in Liz Miller's dorm room like 20 years ago.
And I never saw the live stage version, so I am not going to pretend to be a Rocky Horror expert.
It's worth noting that Rob Zombie grew up in the carnival with carnival worker parents. We could certainly reanalyze all of these movies under that lens, but I'm not going to tackle it today. I will just say that these carnival workers
get taken to a facility where they're told they'll play a game called 31.
It's overseen by a triumvirate with Malcolm McDowell, Judy Geeson, and British star of stage, film, and TV, Jane Carr, announcing that they have 12 hours to fight and survive or die against an assortment of colorful killers. We're talking little people who are dressed up like Nazis. We're talking clowns. We're even talking E.G. Daily. You've known her as Tommy Pickles on Rugrats, Dottie on Pee-wee's Big Adventure. The first role that was a real departure for her was the sex worker at the brothel in Devil's Rejects. Here, she's a killer named Sexhead. After some real artsy experimentation with Halloween 2 and Lords of Salem, 31 was considered kind of simple, but a lot of fans saw it as a return to
the exact kind of Rob Zombie horror story that we had first fallen in love with as fans.
There's no intrigue, no mystery, no conspiracy theory, no twist ending. It's just kill or be killed. The ending, however, is ambiguous. You kind of have to write your own finale, and deciphering its meaning is a whole other conversation.
The numbers I've seen show that 31 cost about $1.5 million to make, made less than $900,000 at the box office, but recouped about $5 or $6 million when you figure in DVD, Blu-ray sales. Maybe there's some streaming rights in there with Shudder. Not sure, but definitely the least performing of the Rob Zombie movies so far. But I think we have Sherry Moon Zombie's most likable protagonist yet. In fact, the whole group of carnival workers are pretty cool people. You have Meg Foster back in there. You have Florence Hilton Jacobs of Cooley High and Welcome Back, Cotter. Jeff Daniel Phillips. But even the poster art will show you this movie belongs to Sherry and Brake. And in press for this movie that I was reviewing, it really struck me how involved Sherry Moon Zombie is in the creative process. I think that muse is the wrong word that people have been using for her, and collaborator is really a much more worthy term.
So as far as what was next, I don't know who all saw it coming.
A
Because the Firefly family had been wiped out 15 years before, hadn't they?
This morning, the search for the fugitives known as the Devil's Rejects resulted in a violent clash with police. The three suspects connected to the House of 1,000 Corpses murders were stopped dead in their tracks today.
May 23rd, 1978. This is the day three of the most infamous outlaws in the history of American crime seemingly met their final fate. 20 bullet wounds apiece. No one would have thought it possible that a single body could survive such a devastating onslaught of destruction. But they did.
And so with the wave of Rob Zombie's hand and a year coma and recovery, the three from hell are back. Spalding, Baby, and Otis. Starting off a little Helter Skelter and a little Natural Born Killers, Three from Hell first shows Spalding, Baby, and Otis being convicted of their crimes.
I'm just a clown dancing for the sins of mankind.
It seems the original plan was for all three original characters to break out of prison and start a new crime spree. But Sid Haig's health prevented him from filming, and he only was on set for one day. Captain Spaulding is executed on death row, and good old Sid Haig passed away just a couple days after the movie was released. While the man himself, Sid Haig, is irreplaceable, the movie is called Three from Hell, and Captain Spaulding leaves some big shoes to fill. That's not a clown joke, so Rob Zombie got creative and relied on a cast member that he knew he could trust.
The footage you are about to see was shot on the morning of October 2nd, 1988. The filmmakers who documented this did not survive the experience. This man is Winslow Foxworth Coltrane, a.k.a. the Midnight Wolfman, and the half-brother of Otis Driftwood and Baby Firefly.
So this place is Three from Hell, 10 years after the events of Devil's Rejects, and weaves in Richard Brake as Foxy, like he's always been part of the family.
I'm the most recognizable of the bunch. I'm the Midnight Wolfman.
Seriously? No one knows who you are.
Jeff Daniel Phillips is the cocky warden, and the next section of the movie is Otis and Foxy scheming on how they're going to break Baby out. We get a great parole hearing scene. We see Rob Zombie regular D. Wallace, who is a corrections officer that particularly has it in for Baby. For all the bad things that Otis and Baby have done over 20 years and three movies, Rob Zombie has still chosen to make them the protagonists of Three from Hell. This one really embraces that idea that started about midway through The Devil's Rejects. So let's talk about how that gets pulled off. We are revisiting a lot of beats from Devil's Rejects, but in a new context and maybe with more depth. Instead of a defiant Mama Firefly behind bars, we have Baby, who is given some Halloween 2 Laurie Strode level mental anguish. She is really beginning to crack. Instead of the impromptu Banjo and Sullivan situation, we get a well-thought-out hostage plan as part of the jailbreak plot. There are implications that Otis is still a predator, but it's not referred to as much and definitely not shown on camera. Also, so much more of this is played for laughs, especially with these improv scenes between Richard Brake and Bill Moseley, who met for the first time in production on Three from Hell. But their chemistry is undeniable, and it helps make Otis a lot more likable than the first two films, and really helps establish the new character Foxy in the family dynamic. I'll dare say there was even a couple of times, a couple of mannerisms that just reminded me of what a young Spaulding would be like. So that's all to say, this film could have had a real insurmountable task at hand, but Richard Brake just really nails it. It is so cosmically appropriate that Sid Haig was the one who recommended him in the first place. Yes, that is Sherry Moon Zombie in a sombrero. She also wears a war bonnet at one point. Look, you're this far into the Rob Zombie filmography, you just gotta be used to problematic stuff. So I'll avoid spoilers, which would include a bunch of brutal footage I can't show anyway, but needless to say, the family is reunited, and then the film becomes Firefly Family Mexican Vacation? It's fun to see a different dynamic between Richard Brake and Sherry Moon Zombie than we saw in 31, and really this is where we get to see all of the silliness between these brothers and sister.
Come on, that's your best shot.
Oh,
we also get a sweet scene that on paper is about Baby and Otis remembering their fallen family members, but it also serves as a tribute to the actors that have departed over the last 20 years from these three films.
You ever think maybe it's not worth it?
Thinking about Cutter?
Yeah. Everybody's gone. It's just the two of us.
Yeah. That's the past.
Hey, I'm here and down for anything.
I mean, the two of us. That's the future.
Come on, man. What am I, invisible or what?
The three of us.
Everything that follows is a parallel to the back half of The Devil's Rejects, but now with a Quentin Tarantino, Robert Rodriguez comic book, Yo Jimbo, Fistful of Dollars type of tone. Very similar situation financially to 31. It cost a couple million to make, made back a little less than that at the box office as part of a event kind of thing, but recouped plenty and made a profit in Blu-ray and DVD sales and probably streaming rights with Shudder. It remains to be seen if this is just the business model from now on. After all, with the Munsters, Universal produced it and it got put right on Netflix. No box office numbers to speak of, probably some DVD and Blu-ray profits. But that was a different kind of film, and it seems like Rob Zombie wants to do different kind of films from now on. Rob Zombie's dream project, the TV show that he watched as a little boy, he finally got to make a feature film of it all these years after starting on Pee-wee's Playhouse. And it has his favorite traveling troupe of actors, including Sherry Moon Zombie. Great sets, great costumes, over-the-top acting, funny, punny comedy throughout, fun cameos, and even a Leave It to Beaver reference that goes back to one of the all-time great episodes. This is a perfect spooky season television viewing experience. It is, however, not a cinematic masterpiece. If you're somebody who doesn't like the Munsters and doesn't like Rob Zombie, there is nothing here for you. Even if you like those things, this ends on a very abrupt note. Feels very much like an incomplete pilot for a reboot series we're never going to get, unless I'm totally wrong about what I see as divisive online reaction and this is actually a sleeper hit that they're going to make more of. The Variety interview with Rob Zombie makes me feel like he did the best with what he had, and we should enjoy it for what it is this Halloween. And again, I say this as somebody who loved it and even teared up a little bit at the love story.
Just like our heroes, question mark, at the end of Three from Hell, Rob Zombie has an uncertain future, but infinite possibilities ahead of him. So till we see where that journey takes him, this is Video of the Damned. Thanks for watching my analysis of the Rob Zombie filmography. I remain Hub.
Adios, motherfucker.